First of all, I'd like to thank the organizers, Anton and Maxim, for organizing this fantastic event. And it's really my pleasure to be here. So my first thanks to organizers. And when preparing this talk, I was thinking what will be the topic which kind of intersects with Samson's scientific interests. And I think, I hope that I will show that in many places it touches Samson's interests, which are very interesting. So I'll mention this. And finally, just I will say more probably later, but let me mention that Samson came to Leningrad in 81, in the year 1981. And he was very young fellow, but he had remarkable gift. He can make friends with many people, young and old. I'll tell more, but before I'll start this talk, let me show some of the Samson friends whom he made in the 80s. Yeah. So. Okay, so this ends informal introduction. This is Trinity College, Dublin. And now let's start. So the topic originated from local mirror symmetry, and one of the most important papers was by Anganagic, Digraph, Clem, Marinho, and Waffen. They studied mirror symmetry for local toric Calabi-Yau threefolds. And the typical example they consider, and many other people consider, is when the Calabi-Yau manifold is a total space of canonical bundle over toric Delpezze surface. So that's what's written over there. It's a canonical bundle over a surface S. And there are very simple examples of such toric surfaces, like P2 is the basic example. Another example is Hirzebruch surfaces, which are also very simple. It's P2 blown at 0, 1, 2, 3 points. Then there are non-smooth examples, which are weighted projected spaces. There are much more, but this will be sufficient. Even in this talk, I'll consider only one example, which will be also interesting. So, but this is the general setup. So this is a non-compact Calabi-Yau threefold. That's why it's, and then the result is that corresponding mirror manifold is given by precise equation. For this can be described explicitly. It corresponds to Landau-Ginzburg model with potential, superpotential W. The equation is written over there. It defines a manifold in a product of C2 times C star 2, because it's natural to consider E of P and E of Q, where P and Q are just complex coordinates. Then in these examples I mentioned before, the mirror curve is just elliptic curve and can be given by a very simple equation. For instance, for the basic example, when S is the Hirzebruch surface F0, the superpotential has this very simple form. There are two complex parameters, or rather real, say, zeta positive plays the role of physical mass, and kappa is a modulus of corresponding elliptic curve. These precise equations were discovered long ago by physicists. They were used by mathematicians like Aru, Katsarkov, Arlov. They were studying these examples very carefully because they are like a playing ground where you can test many things. When your Delpezze surface is a weighted projective space, you have another equation, which is also very simple. And this was known long ago. But then, surprisingly, it was said the idea was in the air for many years, starting from that paper by Anganagic and other people and her friends. But here, Marinho had an idea that one need, well, it, which came from integrable systems, and it was probably at the same time when Samson, together with Nikita, were studying quantum integrable systems, Baxter equation, their relation to supersymmetric quantum field theories. At the same time, roughly, Marcus Marinho and his collaborators, Grassi, Hatsuda, and other, they had an idea that one needs to quantize these mirror curves, basically by replacing classical coordinates P and Q by quantum mechanical operators, capital P and capital Q, position and momentum operators. And as a result, so that's the idea. Then instead of equation of a quantum curve, we have an eigenvalue problem for the corresponding quantum mechanical operator. And there are many interesting questions, both from physics, from mirror symmetry, and from the spectral theorem. So in this talk, I will be concentrating on the spectral properties of this operators as operators in the Hilbert space, so that the Hilbert space structure will be very important. And so, but first it was discovered by Marinho and his co-authors that this operators has several remarkable properties. This, well, properties mean conjectures. So they made the following conjectures, that spectral properties of this quantum mechanical operators on the line is the simplest quantum mechanics with 1 degree of freedom. They encode in some way the enumerative geometry of the toric Calabi-Yau threefold X, the original manifold we started in the mirror symmetry. More precisely, they are related to invariants like Gromov-Witten, Gopa-Kumar-Waffa, and other things in some rather complicated way. The second, also, that the spectral theory of this operators, which we'll discuss, provides a non-perturbative definition of the topological string theory on initial manifold X. So that's what studying quantum mechanics on a mirror manifold allows to define non-perturbatively the topological strings on Calabi-Yau threefold. Obviously, I won't discuss these properties. These are two main problems, and they're rather deep and kind of difficult. So what I will discuss some very simple things, which should be like a basic quantum mechanics, introduction to quantum mechanics. Let's put it this way. Okay. So first, very briefly, let's remind the Weyl operators. So our Hilbert space will be L2 on the line, the very basic. Then we consider Heisenberg operators P and Q, quantum mechanical operators. Here I put H bar equals to 1, it will reappear later in a different context. And then we define Weyl operators. Usually, in quantum mechanics, we are taught that Weyl operators are unitary operators. There is P and Q, capital P and capital Q, are self-adjoint operators in a Hilbert space. They define, each of them, one parameter group of unitary operators, and these unitary operators satisfy Hermann-Weyl commutation relations. And then the one-parameter group means the parameter is real, on the real line. But in this setup, the parameter is pure imaginary. So instead of considering unitary operators bounded, we have self-adjoint unbounded operators, namely in this setup. We have operators U and V, which are just exponents of self-adjoint operators P and Q. They exist as a nice unbounded self-adjoint operators in the Hilbert space. And B is a positive constant. It kind of plays the role of a Planck constant. You can absorb it in P and Q, obviously. And then they satisfy on their common domain this Hermann-Weyl-like relation. This is not a true relation everywhere, because when you have unbounded operators in a Hilbert space, you cannot state any algebraic relation between them, because domains may be different, you need to be very careful. So this relation is understood formally on a common domain, which is invariant under the action of U and V. And then they obviously satisfy this relation.
Something like polynomial times quadratic exponent.
Exactly, exactly. For instance, this is the domain which is invariant. Yes, yes. But by no means this is true in general, that such relation holds. So this is rather formal. And of course, example, using Schrödinger representation, we can realize operator U as a shift in imaginary direction in L2 on the line, and V as a multiplication by exponent. Obviously, V is a nice self-adjoint operator, just multiplication by a function. But it may look weird that a pure imaginary shift is a self-adjoint operator. This is true, and this is very simple. Like shift in a real direction is unitary, shift in pure imaginary is obviously self-adjoint. The easiest way to see it is to use a Fourier transform. And then you can describe their domains explicitly. This is very simple to describe domains of these self-adjoint operators. And I like to say that this is self-adjoint in a true mathematical sense. It's not Hermitian operators, which means either symmetric or whatever. It's self-adjoint in precise definition, that each operator with dense domain has closable, has an adjoint, and they are equal. So this is precisely what we mean by a self-adjoint. So these are the basic operators, and well, that's how we define their inverses. Their V is positive, U is also similar to a positive operator. So that's the basic setup. These are just two formulas we need to we'll be using throughout this talk. And then the functional difference operator, for instance, in this setup, when S is a Hirzebruch surface, then we have a family of operators, H of zeta, which is a very symmetric expression. Say, for instance, if zeta is 1, it's like U plus U inverse plus V inverse. Each of the terms is a self-adjoint operator, but in general, it's not true that the sum of two unbounded self-adjoint operators is self-adjoint. There could be some problems. But in this case, one can prove that this is truly self-adjoint operator in a Hilbert space. And why this operator is so interesting and kind of the basic, because if we can set zeta to be 1, like a mass, then its symbol has a remarkable symmetry. Its symbol is a sum of two hyperbolic cosines. And this is an analog of a usual quantum mechanical oscillator, whose symbol is psi square plus pi square. So if you expand for small beta, you get a harmonic oscillator. Minus four, I guess. If you subtract 4 and expand, it's a harmonic oscillator. So this operator should have some remarkable properties, as harmonic oscillator does. So, and this is the operator which just came from mirror curves. It was never studied neither by mathematicians in spectral theory of differential operators, because H formally is a pseudo-differential operator of infinite order. Because if you expand, it's a pseudo-differential operator of infinite order. But remarkably, its properties are very close to the second order differential operator, to the Schrödinger operator. So it came in this way. So there are two, and this is also another remark, kind of interesting, is that you can discretize Schrödinger operator, and usually people replace second derivative by a second difference. then this operator with second difference has different properties because it becomes unitary. But this is a better approximation replacing by functional difference in imaginary direction. So that's the proper discretization of Schrödinger operator rather of second derivative.
Sorry, but before we determined functional difference equations when you have continuous, there's no difference replacement. It was unitary. Do you care about helicity or?
No, this is if you have instead of imaginary shift, you have like x plus b, it will be unitary, obviously. It will be unitary, right? It's a shift operator. And then it's kind of interesting that in fact, when the mass zeta is zero, this operator, which I call h of zero, which is u plus u inverse plus v, already appeared in our work with Ludwig Fadeev when we were discussing quantum Liouville model on the lattice. This was the trace of local monodromy matrix. Then this operator appeared in representation theory of quantum group SL2R and so on. And I remember that when around that time, Dan Friedan was visiting Soviet Union. He was in Moscow and in Leningrad. And when he came to Steklov Institute, I think Samson was there. We discussed with Fadeev, with Dan Friedan, because he was interested, obviously, in Liouville theory at that time it was. And of course, that's where this operator came from. Then later it was studied extensively by Kashaev, because if one considers kind of deformation, quantization of the Teichmüller space considered as a symplectic manifold with Weyl-Petersen symplectic form, then this operator H plays the role of a Dent-Twist operator. That's what Rinat Kashaev was discussing. So this has a long history, but surprisingly that the spectral theory of this operator H, which is very simple, have not been done, although many things were discussed. Yeah. Now that's another set of operators for weighted projective spaces. They have a very nice also property. It's also a self-adjoint operator. And then let me just mention results about this operator, and then I'll discuss them. So, first of all, when the operators H zeta for positive zeta with massive case and this operators H M N can be proved that they have a pure discrete spectrum. The inverse operators are of trace class, and you can compute the asymptotic for the eigenvalue counting function. You can prove the analog of Hermann Weyl law. And instead of area, like for Schrödinger, you get log square with precise constant. So these are theorems, basically, and where the constant C is of this form. So the story is that this is in our paper with mathematicians Laptev and Schimmer, and who got really interested in this operator because they are experts in functional analysis, and people there never seen operators of this type, of this form. And so let me spend maybe 5 minutes to comment on the proof of these results, which are rather general. For instance, let me just mention that this asymptotics for the eigenvalue counting function says that the eigenvalues are very sparse. For instance, n's eigenvalue grows like exponent of square root of n with some coefficient. So they are not like, but of course if you expand, So the main idea of the proof is very simple. It's based on another physics method using coherent state transform, which maps L2 on the line into L2 on the plane. This is not, this is a partial isometry. It cannot be isometry defined by this form. And then there is some kind of remarkable identity which reflects integrability of these operators. And this single identity allows to prove all these results. Namely, if you compute quadratic form of operator H in terms of the coherent state transform, then quadratic form exhibits the symbol of the operator. The symbol of the operator appears in a quadratic form with some constants d1 and d2. So that's the, and if you, and using this thing and the standard techniques estimating Ries sums, Ries means, which are written over there, it's a sum function of lambda, which is the sum over all eigenvalues less than lambda, lambda minus lambda j, summation over all j such that lambda j is less than lambda, then you get the identity, and then one can estimate it from above and below by the same constant using Jensen's inequality, convexity, and this representation, using two different type of representation. So this is basically very simple, and the key is this formula for the quadratic form of the operator. And of course, it's also non-difficult, rather easy to prove that these operators have a discrete spectrum. And then from this, from the veil law, it follows that they are of the trace class, inverses of the trace class. And these are all positive operators. And then, so that's the what was discussed before. And of course, the main thing, which the conjecture stated by Marinier and co-authors, says that in fact these operators are of trace class, inverses of these operators are of trace class. One can define Fredholm determinant of these operators as entire function, and then its asymptotic expansion of the Fredholm determinant or traces of the all positive powers of the inverse operator encode enumerative invariance of the Calabi-Yau threefold. And this conjecture of Marinier is very complicated because it uses Nekrasov-Shetashvili function, it uses a lot of ingredients, some Nekrasov-Shetashvili limit, some kind of quantum theta functions. It's really very involved. Yeah. But this simple operators seem to carry this information. But before this, we study the massless operator. And this is also another interesting story where Samson was involved, because in 2012 we invited Fadeev to the Simons Center, and he came probably for a month or maybe for 4 weeks or whatever. And then he was, Fadeev was working with this operator for quite a while. And then, but somehow, when we ask him what is the spectral properties, what is the resolvent of this operator, they didn't study. And so I started to study this, and then we developed the full, it's a very simple operator, and we developed the scattering theory for this operator, like it's precisely like a Schrödinger operator with a potential that grows exponentially at one end and decays very fast at the other end. And this can be done very nicely, but there is some interesting feature of this analysis which I like to outline. Is the following. So, like, let's consider, we think of the operator of Schrödinger type, namely u plus u inverse replaces the negative second derivative operator, and v is a potential. And then, like we know from elementary quantum mechanics or functional analysis, that the Green's function for the second derivative operator is continuous on a diagonal, and its first derivative is discontinuous. And therefore, the delta function, which appears in the equation for the Green's function, comes from Heaviside formula. The derivative of a jump is a delta function at this point. Here we have no, here the resolvent, let's consider the unperturbed, the free operator, H naught, which is U plus U inverse. It's an integral operator. It can easily be solved by Fourier transform. Then integrating back, it's integral operator of this form. Let me, of this form. integral operator, where this is a nice smooth function everywhere, is smooth at x equals zero. And then how come that this resolvent satisfy the equation h of r equals lambda times r plus delta function? How, what is the mechanism how the delta function appears? And it turns out that it's kind of interesting. It appears because of Sachotsky-Plemel formula, so which can one can think of as a smooth version of Heaviside formula. So, namely, it's easy to prove, well, it's elementary rather, that we get this, that this property follows from Sachotsky-Plemel formula, where this you can consider as a smooth version of a Heaviside function. Also, it may be important, maybe not, but Polyakov observed that this expression is can be interpreted as a one-particle partition function for Bose-Einstein statistics. This is, of course, trivial because you expand denominator into geometric series and you get Bose-Einstein partition function. But maybe it's important, maybe not. Yeah, but anyway, this is the Sachotsky-Plemel formula from which the whole thing follows. And then we have a free resolvent. Then one can study the solution of the eigenvalue problem, scattering solution, where lambda is parameterized by two hyperbolic cosine of 2 pi bk, sorry. And then, actually, in this case, one can think of this problem as a Schrödinger operator on a half line from zero to infinity. Then it is known that it has Yost solutions and a scattering solution, which is zero at the origin. And then the scattering solution here can be written nicely as a Fourier transform of a product of two Fadeev's quantum dilogarithm functions. And Yost solutions can be also defined. And then we have precisely the same formula as for the Schrödinger equation, that the scattering solution is a linear combination of the Yost solutions, where this will define the Plancherel measure. This will define the spectral function. The modulus square inverse defines the spectral function for this operator. All this is very simple, but this is, one can think of this operator as a Q analog of the Schrödinger operator with potential e to the x, whose solutions are modified Bessel functions of the second kind. And then orthogonality and completeness relation, spectral decomposition for this operator, is classic result in theory of special functions. It's called Kantorovich-Lebedev transform. And this can be, so this can be considered as a Q analog of Kantorovich-Lebedev transform. Then the resolvent for the perturb operator has very simple formula, is the same type like for the Schrödinger operator, and then starting, and then this, the last operator U, which is a unitary operator from L2 on the line to L2 on the half line with the spectral measure, is defines the spectral decomposition because operator UH, U inverse, is a multiplication operator. So this finishes the spectral theory for this operator, for operator H. This is very simple, so I'll just mention it. Now, what happens with the operator, with our operators when the mass is non-zero? So, and then there is a whole story which is rather involved, because there is a conjecture. Starting from Nekrasov-Shetashvili paper, we know that total lattice, that periodic total lattice is integrable, and one can find some exact quantization conditions using Nekrasov-Shetashvili function, which is a Young-Young potential for this theory. And this Nekrasov-Shetashvili function is obtained as a superpotential for some supersymmetric gauge theory in a rather complicated fashion. So that's the story. In particular, for the simplest Schrödinger operator, second negative second derivative plus hyperbolic cosine, there is some quantization condition, which is impossible to check because it uses Nekrasov-Shetashvili function. So there is some interesting story going on even with the classical, with modified Mathieu equation, when you replace ordinary cosine potential by a hyperbolic cosine. This gives a new result from Nekrasov-Shetashvili theory. Yeah, but then the claim is made by Marinier and Hatsuda and other people, it's a conjecture that for all this integrable operators from mirror curves, there is a certain quantization condition, exact, which uses two ingredients. One ingredient is Nekrasov-Shetashvili function, which should be used for the operators and the dual operators. I forget to mention that we have a pair U and V, and then there is a dual pair U tilde, say, and V tilde, which formally commute with U and V, only formally. They don't commute as self-adjoint, but formally they commute, and they have corresponding Q tilde. It's like B goes to 1 over B of this sort. And then you, for one Q, you construct one Nekrasov-Shetashvili function. For another Q tilde, you construct function for Q tilde. Then the quantization condition is for the sum of these two functions, F plus F tilde. And then this but this is a quantization conditions for the eigenvalues of the discrete spectrum. And this is remarkable, that usually when in defining Young-Young superpotential from supersymmetric gauge theories, you don't usually pay attention whether your solution is. Is it in L2 or in some other space? But in this case, this quantization condition defines a true L2 function, which is solution of the eigenvalue problem, which is kind of mysterious, and it's really, if it really holds, it's a miracle. But there is a second part of a story, that this quantization condition doesn't, the energy, the eigenvalues are not directly involved in this quantization condition. It's rather a certain function of these energies. And this certain function is obtained as a quantum A period of the mirror curve. And this is the object which nobody knows how to compute, the quantum A period of a mirror curve. Mirror curve is elliptic curve. It has A and B periods which can be computed. And they are used to obtain semi-classical asymptotics of the eigenvalues. But the quantum A period, whatever it means, there is some conjecture by Waffer, Diagraaff, but it's not clear what it really means. These quantum periods allowed to determine how the lambda eigenvalue depends on the parameter t in Nekrasov-Shetashvili function. So there are two conditions involved. One is a pure quantization condition, and another is change of variables. And so whether it's very useful or not, it's not clear, because for potential Cosh x, for Schrödinger operator, there is also Gutzwiller quantization condition, which is also exact. Probably Gutzwiller condition in this case is a special case of Nekrasov-Shetashvili, but this would be interesting to check. I think maybe Teschner checked it, maybe not. It's not clear. But
in some cases, Teschner checked. I think for Todd, he
checked. Yeah, but either it's exactly that Yo is Gutzwiller condition, exactly.
That Gutzwiller he did not discuss.
No. Yeah, but Gutzwiller in his work, because Gutzwiller was the first who proved that the quantum, periodic quantum Todd lattice is completely integrable, and he gave exact quantization condition. Later it was explained by separation of variables. So
he had done some formula that if you take same function W and differentiate with respect to zeta, right, it enters as a parameter, then that will give the energy, evaluating all the solutions of discrete spectrum.
Right.
And that's exactly what Teschner checked.
Uh-huh. Right, but it would be interesting to check correspondence with Gutzwiller. Okay, so, and then the idea was that since this exact quantization conditions are very difficult, and the conjecture that there is another way to treat the eigenvalues is consider the trace identities. Namely, you have Fredholm determinant, which is entire function of a parameter lambda, its zeros are precisely the eigenvalues, then one can study either its behavior when parameter lambda is zero, just Taylor expansion, but then one can consider its asymptotics for large lambda. And asymptotics for large lambda contain a lot of information about eigenvalues. They kind of reflect sum of eigenvalues, sum of squares of the eigenvalues regularized. So, and this is the thing which one can do. So I'll finish by giving some ideas how these trace identities work, because that's the approach that kind of related to the Schrödinger operator and which probably can be done nicely in this case. And so let me briefly review the history of the trace identities for Schrödinger and this type of operators. Yeah. So that's what I said, that you have a regularized determinant of the operator. I write it in this form, it should be regularized, it's a Fredholm determinant, and then you consider the asymptotics of this operator for large values of parameter lambda and express it in terms of the coefficients. So first, let's start with the basic example. It's a Schrödinger operator with a potential V of x, either on the interval with some boundary conditions or on a whole line, half line, anywhere with appropriate boundary conditions. First, let's consider Sturm-Liouville operator on 0 pi, say, with smooth potential V of x. This is, of course, celebrated Gelfand-Levitan-Dicke trace identity. That's a beautiful formula of Gelfand-Levitan, where you consider Sturm-Liouville operator on the interval, say, with 0 Dirichlet boundary conditions. Then you sum of the eigenvalues obviously diverge, you regularize it, there is a canonical way, then it equals to the integral of a potential. So that's Gelfand-Levitan, 1953 or something like that. And then, of course, this was developed further by Gelfand and Dicke, and there is the whole beautiful machinery of trace identities. Well, Schrödinger operator on a half line. Then on an interval, there is no condition on a potential, just smoothness is sufficient. On a half line, then, of course, potential should be rapidly decreasing. Then there is what is called Buslaev-Fadeev trace identities, which also express regularized sum of eigenvalues plus a contribution from a continuous spectrum in terms of the potential. It's some integrals of potential V of x, its derivatives, values of V at x equals 0, its derivatives, and so on. There is a complete characterization. Then when you consider Schrödinger operator on a line with rapidly decreasing potential, then you can generalize Buslaev-Fadeev. It will be Fadeev-Zakharov trace identities, which everybody knows because you use them for complete integrability of the KdV equation, which express precisely that certain spectral data is in terms of integrals of potential of polynomials of potential V of x and its derivatives, so which trace identities represent all local commuting integrals for the KdV on a real line with rapidly decreasing case. There are also integrals in periodic boundary condition, but that's a different story. I won't discuss it. So its periodic boundary condition also can be considered. Lambda should go to negative infinity. Thank you. Yeah, negative.
Yeah.
Right. I'll write it exactly. Right. So now let's. This is just what I said before. We consider pure discrete spectrum. What is determinant of H is difficult to define because you need a family. But if you have a family, you can define a normalized determinant by this, either by Adamard product. If the operator H inverse is of trace class, then the sum of the eigenvalues or rather one over eigenvalues converge. This is Adamard product. Or you define if your operator is not, if H inverse is not of trace class, but some of, but its power is of trace class. You define it somewhat differently. If H inverse minus epsilon for some small epsilon, you define it like that. And so basically, that's the object. Our operators from mirror curves, they belong to the first class. They belong to this class. And so this, and this is basically Fredholm determinant. All you need to replace lambda by 1 over lambda, doesn't matter. This is Fredholm determinant, just ordinary determinant, characteristic determinant of an operator. So we have these properties. And then, well, there is another simple. Now, how to obtain asymptotics of this determinant when lambda goes to minus infinity? And how they are related to the distribution of the eigenvalues? Well, we define the operator zeta function to H operator H. We define the operator zeta function, which is given by this series for real S large enough, in our case, greater than 1, even 1/2, depends. And then, since the operator zeta function admits a meromorphic continuation to the whole S-plane, then we can, just by Millin transform, you can express log of this determinant as an integral of the operator zeta function with these factors, where you integrate along the vertical line in a complex plane, and sigma is large, say greater than 0. And then to get asymptotics of this determinant when lambda goes to minus infinity is very simple. You shift the contour of integration to minus infinity. And how far you shift, you get asymptotic, you get terms of your expansion plus an error term. So this is, and if you shift it to infinity, you get asymptotic series. Otherwise, you get exact formula with a remainder term. So that's standard representation like everywhere. And so that's one way of obtaining the asymptotics. And then, of course, here we see, like, naively that since zeta function admits an analytic continuation, poles are at when s is an integer, say when s is a positive integer, well, you don't go to the right, you go to the left. When s is a negative integer, then you get inverse powers of lambda. Inverse powers of lambda, and values of zeta n, zeta of s at s equals to negative integer. So you get regularized, sum of eigenvalues, squares, and so on by zeta function, and you get this expansion. So that's the standard part. Now, the non-trivial part is to obtain the same expansion using the potential V of x, to get a different representation for this asymptotic series, which is obtained from this formula. What I said is just a way of defining the sum of the eigenvalue, sum of square, how to regularize this and this. Now, and then there is a way, which I put it here in rather cryptic form, but I can explain. So how can one do it for Schrödinger? Now we are discussing Schrödinger equation with growing potential. With growing potential of such that the spectrum is discrete. How to get a trace formulas for this class? This was not really considered. But then there is a way of, if operator is positive, you consider asymptotics when lambda goes to negative infinity. It's like doing WK beam method without turning points. And this was known long before WKB. It's called Liouville-Green method, when there is no turning points. And in some cases, which one should be very careful, Liouville-Green method gives uniform asymptotics for large negative lambda, it's large negative energies, and uniformly in x. Then doing this, so you can see the solution of this equation for any lambda negative, so it cannot be an eigenvalue. And then you consider solution which decays at one end, say at plus infinity, and then consider its asymptotics by this Liouville-Green method when lambda goes to negative infinity, and this asymptotics should be uniform in x. So that's the leading term. When then subtracting this asymptotics, you can reduce your Schrödinger equation to Riccati equation, but you need to know what to subtract. This Liouville-Green says precisely to Riccati equation, where instead of a potential will be some combination of potential and terms of this Liouville-Green formula. So it depends how fast potential grows to infinity, involves certain integration, and this can be done explicitly, and then you can get Riccati. You get Riccati equation, and you get coefficients in the asymptotic expansion. Here, I didn't write it because here you expand this in inverse powers of lambda with coefficients, and then you can get these coefficients recursively by using Riccati equation. So you get a bunch of given potential. Either if potential is, you get some integrals of these derivatives, and or if potential is given like e to the x or hyperbolic cosine, you get a bunch of numbers. Let's consider a couple of examples. This brings us to the 19th century, actually. So first, the trivial example, the harmonic oscillator. We all know that it's kind of discrete spectrum, but in fact, all solutions are important. They give special functions. Parabolic cylinder functions called Weber functions. Then this is the determinant, its inverse gamma function with coefficients. And then trace identities obtained by Liouville-Green method gives precisely the Stirling formula for gamma functions. So trace identities are very meaningful because they combine information from two different points. So this gives Stirling formula for gamma function. So there's one example where you cannot make a simple example. Then the second case, as I mentioned before, when potential is e to the 2x on the half line with Dirichlet boundary conditions at the origin. Solutions are modified Bessel function of the second kind. Then determinant is just this k is a MacDonald function, k function, evaluated at point 1, because log 1 is 0. And then it's function k of I square root of lambda. And this, so again, you get using asymptotic expansion of this at lambda goes to infinity. There is by Green-Liouville method, you obtain formulas for the sum of the zeros of Bessel function, the squares, regularized sums. Actually, just as a side remark, this is a toy operator which Poya was using when he discussed approximation, some naive approximation to Riemann zeta function. It's not important. Now, the last case. The last case is very, excuse me, the last case is rather involved, but there is a similarity since operator, although H is now pseudo-differential operator of infinite order, it behaves like a second order differential operator. And one can also develop the analog of Liouville-Green method and obtain the corresponding trace identities. I hope to tell about it maybe next time at Samson's birthday, maybe next year. But this, some details are rather involved, but this can be considered as a constructive way of obtaining some invariants like Gopa, Kummer, Waffe and others from this trace identities, because this potential is just hyperbolic cosine. Therefore, coefficients and trace identities will give us a bunch of numbers doing some obtained by some weird integrals. And then one can compare this bunch of numbers with exact invariants, like Marini and his co-authors were doing. It's not done completely, but that's a way of to avoid these quantization conditions and quantum A periods, because this is not really, because it's very difficult,
and
not doable, right, and get some information. And the key, of course, is that this remarkable operator is as nice as harmonic oscillator. So, of course, we cannot get a formula for the eigenvalues, but we can completely characterize its eigenfunctions, or maybe the general solution, like parabolic cylinder functions, in terms of some integral representation. What we mean, we have a special functions, meaning that we have a function like Bessel function, we have some serious expansion, which doesn't help much, but we have an integral representation, which really is the thing which allows us to connect behavior at large and at small values of parameters. Same should be here, because this is a remarkable operator which should be even better than harmonic oscillator. So probably this is like the bottom line of this talk, that one should look at this operator very carefully. And I think, yeah, it's time to stop. So that's happy birthday, Samson.
Maybe questions or comments?
So you gave some examples of those kind of funny operators with exponential potential and with the shifts which behave as second order operators. Is it clear what is the class? Kind of, right, there were many examples, but is there some more general class of operators which behave similar to second-order differential operators?
I think operator U plus U inverse, you can add anything. You can add capital V, you can add small v of x would be of the same class. U plus U inverse just shifts in plus and minus imaginary directions. That's the true analog of a second derivative.
And then an arbitrary potential.
Arbitrary
reasonable
potential. Right, exactly.
Yeah, there is also the Harper operator. Can you use it to get some information?
Yes, exactly. That's a very good point. When we consider the case when U and V are self-adjoint. If U and V are unitary, that's the famous Hofstadter-Harper model. But this is a totally different operator. It has a periodic spectrum. It's like Schrödinger, it's like Mathieu equation with cosine x and hyperbolic cosine. Spectral theory for one doesn't correspond to spectral. They are kind of like some analytic continuation. Yeah, so, yeah.
Anything?
Jean-Michel.
Okay,
Jean-Michel.
Yes. Does a zeta function verify functional equation?
I don't know.
I'm asking this because for the harmonic oscillator, the spectrum is integer, so you get the classical zeta function.
Right. That's, you know, there's some weird equation Bender, you know, wrote, yeah. But it's not true. Yeah. What Bender, you know Bender.
Do you think anybody tried to consider elliptic difference analog of these equations? Because it's like two different separators.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, when one can try more complicated mm-hmm. locus recalabio correspond to not torrid but elliptic surface.
Uh-huh.
You don't know.
No, I don't know. It will be very interesting. This is like the baby example, right? But it's very.
Let's thank the speaker again.